Could we address the issue on the next issue on the agenda, 70 Parkwood Drive? Kathy, do you know who that is?
He was there.
There he is. Parkwood Drive. You're up.
So I was not the one.
We're trying to fill in the gap.
Don't be offended if we interrupt you when they come back. It's just to make efficient use of the time.
Hope I'm easier than that one. All right, my name's Brian Maloney. I live at 70 Parkwood Drive in Milton, and moved there about 2 or 3 years ago, and I have a bunch of dead trees in the back, our backyard, and they're look like totem poles, basically, and they're leaning, some of them are leaning over towards our yard. And someone up the street chopped down some trees and didn't get permission to do so. I never experienced anything like this. So I said to my wife, maybe we should call and ask permission before we...
Thank you.
So that's why I'm here. I took some pictures of the stuff. I actually had a tree that's living, big branch come down and smash my fence and everything. And I had a couple little kids, and I'm just nervous that on a windy day something's going to come down and hurt someone.
Okay. Perfectly understandable. Kathy, have you seen the property?
No, but Julie has.
I have seen it, yes. Okay. I was there. I spoke to your wife.
Okay, yes. Cool.
Yes.
All right. So that's my story, and...
Is it jurisdictional?
It is jurisdictional.
We're going to be out Saturday anyway. Should we go there?
Let's take a look at it. Yeah, let's do that.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah. You know, Pine Tree Brook is at the bottom of where your land slopes down to.
Yeah.
And that's wetland all around it there. Mm-hmm. You can see it. So that's part of our jurisdiction.
Yeah, that's
so
fine.
We'll look at it and see.
So how long does it take to look at it? I mean, I don't mind planting some more trees.
It's a public meeting.
Okay.
And we can make a decision Saturday morning. We should be there by, certainly by 9 o'clock.
Okay. 9 o'clock Saturday, you'll be at my house?
Yes.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Yeah. All right, I'm done.
Perfect, you are done. Right, thank you very much. But yeah, we really...
Yeah.
So I did take the pictures of
the I made three copies just for...
Okay, great.
All right?
That's perfect. And by the way, thank your wife as well. We really appreciate people coming in and asking.
Yeah.
That's very nice.
All right. Thank you for coming in.
All right, thank you. Back on? Yeah, we're back in the record. We're back to 131 Henry.
Okay. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to caucus, so to speak. So really just two things to say. We cannot put this off, and we cannot agree to the speculative possible future plan. We really do want a decision one way or the other. I do have the opportunity perhaps to reiterate through Phil what I asked a little differently. So, Phil, do you want to kind of restate what I was trying to say?
Sure. From my position, again, technically speaking, not legally, you know, we've gone around and around on a number of different topics, and we haven't really honed in on the specific aspects of the plan that the commission, you know, most strongly disagrees with specificity. You know, we've talked about open space tonight. We've testified that we have more open space as a result of this plan than as what's out there today. We're just reconfiguring it. Maybe that's not to the commission's liking, but the reality is those are the numbers. That's how it's proposed. So I think for my benefit for this application, I think for your ultimate deliberations, you know, we should start putting forth the specific points relative to this plan, that are not satisfactory to the commission relative to the Protection Act.
All right. On your calculations, if you were to take the macadam out and plant grass there, how would your calculations look then?
Well, again, our calculations are, open space or pervious, or, whoever we want to term it,
critical to us, and that makes a difference to us. You're using apples, and we're using oranges.
No, I don't think we are. We kind of group everything together. In our world, it's either open to the sky or it's not. You know, so it's green space, you're standing on something that is living and growing and is open to the sky, that's pervious, or it's impervious, which is sidewalk, building, parking lot. I mean, that's it. So the way you've termed open space is the same way I term pervious. So I think we are talking apples to apples here.
No, we're not. We're saying open space is open that nothing is built on it. There's no structure on it. So we're including the macadam-covered open lot on the corner of Elliott and Central as open space.
I mean, think City Hall Plaza in Boston. It's open space, even though it's paved, but it's still open space that people can use, and you know, the air circulates, so.
That's why I think it's very important for the record to reflect that we're not using the same terms and the same definition.
You know, maybe in the application of, you know, City Hall, where we have brick pavers as open space, which is, you know, we have limited brick pavers out here, we consider that, you know, pervious cover for the purposes of our drainage calculations. Water is allowed to get through it. Obviously, the brick pavers that are out there come out as part of the project, and we go to the truest sense of the definition, green open space, as what's shown on the plan. So is there, maybe there is wiggle room in our definitions, and we're talking slightly differently. But at the end of the day, what is being provided, I believe meets the criteria that you're trying to put forth.
And even, I think with what you're getting at, I mean, if you take the strip of land along Elliott, is greater in square footage than the macadam area at the corner, right, Chris? I mean, mm-hmm. Just a simple calculation.
Plus this entire area out front is paved now, which we're turning back into green, and we have a nice sitting wall with brick pavers backed up by an upper terrace of planking. And the building comes right to the side back of the sidewalk the entire length of this right here, and that's going to be all green, planted lawn, shrubs, trees.
And this is exactly behind the question that I asked relative to the measures. And I'm, in my mind, faced with a pinball machine that's running from trees to wind to grass with no common definition. It seems it's continuously moving pieces. And we have to somehow settle on a commonly understood definition of what we mean by the open space.
No building. I don't care what the surface is. If it's macadam,
then we meet that with no problem. We meet that. If that's the deciding factor, then we absolutely meet that. Area that is not occupied by building. We have a surplus of open space as a result of this plan versus what's out there now.
Well, I'd like to see those numbers, because I think thus far, I've been listening to you, and I'm under the impression that we're losing a lot of what I call open space, albeit space with macadam surface. And I'm pointing to that corner where the tree was. And I don't want to get back to the tree, because that's not the issue. It's more of an open space issue. But in my view, by removing the tree, which had a huge root ball, I mean, that's monstrous, that allowed you to fill that space with a building. That's why, at least from my own perspective, that's why I'm using that term open space, because that which was open with that large tree, even that monstrous root ball, you've now filled that with a building. That's the loss that I see that we're taking under the interest that we protect. And that's why I think the enforcement order is kind of, it's a sticking point for us. It's not the tree, but by removing the tree, you just fill that space with a building, where you wouldn't have been able to do that if you left the tree there.
But if I may, I mean, on that point, that's where Steve's detailed explanation is important. Yes, it's acknowledged, mea culpa, it was cut down without permission. But if they had gone for permission, you would have granted permission, because it was clearly unsafe. We've heard new testimony tonight from a neighbor familiar with it. It was the arborist. I have no doubt that if the applicant had time, or whether it was a time issue or whatever it was, but if they had come to the commission, you would have recognized, as sad as it was, that tree had to come down. So
there was disagreement, Peter, and we had an arborist come in and say that it had another 20 years left. Well, now, 20 years is not 200 years, I get it. but it wasn't a clear-cut issue, and there was some disagreement among the arborists. I think we had three. Mm-hmm. We had what, the whoever the tree whisperer was. That's what he called himself.
That was...
I forget his name.
Twig Largesse.
How could I forget?
Tree guy named Twig. It's like an ice cream man named Cone.
Come on.
I can't talk that.
He's really like a Kurt Vonnegut in a role.
He was brought up from the planning board from Jamestown, Rhode Island. He's a tree advocate. He's not an objective opinion on that tree. The two arborists that gave opinions on that tree, one was Maltby Company, which was a bidder for the RFP that the town put out to hire an arborist. And Maltby Company's opinion was the tree had to come down.
I don't think we need to revisit this
well,
again.
You do.
It's relevant to the question of, taking that macadam area.
What you're talking about, that tree on that corner, the root ball, the spread of that thing, the tree had to come down anyway. It doesn't matter what building goes there. It doesn't matter if it's open space. The tree had to come down because of its proximity to the street. It had to be removed. That's just the way it is. I mean, and as you know, when the sidewalks were installed in that intersection 10 years ago, they cut the root system and killed the tree. And everybody knows it.
I don't.
Well, you do now. Because that's what they did. Because
that's the first time I've heard that.
Those things were cut because the grade is a little bit above where the sidewalk was, and most of the oak trees, those roots were about 3 feet below the surface, a lot of ledge and things there. They cut those trees, dug the thing out, put in these concrete sidewalks, and they killed the tree. And then I'm getting penalized for taking it down.
It was controversial, and I don't think that
it is
all of the testimony came in the same way. My memory is that somebody said it's got another 20 years. I don't know who was on the commission at the time.
Well, he's the same person that said that animals need condominiums too. You remember that comment too? You know, I mean, he had a lot to say that night. He went round and around on that thing.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, that's what the guy said. I was like, well, maybe in your world, but not with me. You know?
Sorry, I missed it.
Yeah. Silly question about the quality of open space, and I guess my question is a long narrow strip paralleling a sidewalk along Elliott Street is different from a cohesive space on the corner altogether that mimics perhaps, and I don't want to bring up the tree because I know it's a sore issue, but can we explore the issue of the quality of square footage of open space along narrow strip versus a great area on
the difference between having a room like this to gather versus if we took this room and made it 4 feet wide and all the way, it would be a different function.
That's sort of a social and kind of planning issue, right. But in terms of in terms of a conservation issue, I think there's also a question regarding biological value. Sort of long skinny along a road and a sidewalk is different from a large cohesive area.
But
even though the square footage may be the same.
I understand you're driving at. But the point is, whether it's this application or the proposed special permit from a few years ago, that corner had building on it. Now, the depth of the setback on the special permit was deeper off the intersection coming in from the corner than it is in this proposal, but this still has a green space. Mm-hmm. Which isn't there right now. It's all pavement. Now, the mixed-use proposal is set back a little more, but it still had to hold the street line because of the commercial elements.
Mm-hmm.
So either way, what I'm saying is either way, this argument about this about the corner and about the tree, either way, there's going to be building there.
But you're saying the commercial plan has a little more, it's pulled back?
A little bit more, and there'll be more pavers and things like that for walking, but it's the same premise as what's here right now. It's the same premise.
A little bit more is relative. How much more?
Off the top of my head, I mean, I don't have an exact number for you. But I do know that here, it's set back, on the corner itself, but set back a little bit. The special permit was set back a little bit more.
Do you have a depth dimension of these?
Yeah. Just what hugs the corner. As far as open space is. The premise is the same.
And you end up with a street, more of a streetscape instead of just
the wall of the building for the entire length.
And I would
offer, to me, the streets.
Yeah, nobody wants that.
Right.
It's there now, I think.
But I would offer, on the point about biological, that planted is far more advantageous than unplanted open space.
That's a point I was just going to make, similar to that. I mean, you know, again, two things. That it's not a big square footage, whatever it is, the macadam area in question or controversy, it's not a big area, number one. And in terms of air and that definition of open space, even for the purposes that you ascribe to it, you know, it's, I think it's a very salient difference, especially comparing it to something like City Hall Plaza. City Hall Plaza in Boston is a public amenity. This isn't a public amenity. It's still private property. And, you know, in terms of benefit to the public, it's equally likely, and I think perhaps more beneficial, that there's a much more pleasant green facade, not facade, green strip and continuity of all the way up Elliott Street that's going to contribute and promote the values that you're talking about. Openness and nature, much more than just a little half-circular area that may not, and under your definition, may not be landscape. The fact is, it's not that whole macadam area, but as Phil also just pointed out, I keep stressing the strip all the way up Elliott Street, but there's going to be nice new landscaping along that perimeter of the curved corner as well, which the public is going to benefit from. The public isn't going to benefit from some theoretical half-circular open space that they can't walk on and do anything on. So that's why, again, I really do respectfully disagree.
Okay. How it goes here. All right. Well, obviously, your intent on a vote, I will invite questions from abutters or comments and members of the public. And then you are asking for a vote tonight. That's correct?
Yes.
All right. I want you to know something, that if the vote comes out that the permit is denied, we still remain, which I assume that you'd appeal, but during that process, we still remain ready, willing, and able to participate in a joint effort to move this alternative, which we think would be a better proposition. We still are ready, willing, and able to support a better plan, in my view, certainly, with the planning board, the selectmen, or any other public forum. I just want you to know that if there's a delay in the process, we're not going to sit back and just, you know, twiddle our thumbs, because I think there's a better way. But having said that, are there abutters, first of all, that would like to make a comment or ask a question? Are there members of the public that would like to make a comment or ask a question? Yes, Katie?
Thank you again, Mr. Chairman and members of the Commission. Katie Conlon, member of the Board of Selectmen. In listening to the discussion, I think it would be important that I just mention a couple of things that I'd ask you to keep in mind, bigger picture items as you're making your decision. The town has $320,000 approximately set aside in the reserve fund. Town meeting last night just moved it from the current year's reserve fund to next year's reserve fund to pay for the demolition of our property. It's possible that if we have a denial and there's an appeal and we have a deadline right now of July 31st under the current demolition agreement, it's possible that the town will wind up having to pay for the demolition of its property if we're not able to reach a deal for a different alternative whereby we would transfer the town-owned property to the Conleys for a mixed-use development that would include the Carrick Realty Trust picking up the cost of the demolition. So the demolition cost is an important issue, and that's a big-picture item for the town. I think as a selectman, it's incumbent upon me to bring that to your attention as a factor for you to consider. And as a selectman, I'm asking that we consider, I understand that there's statutory jurisdiction that this board is responsible for, and I have great respect for the members here and the time you put in and the commitment you make to the environmental issues and the conservation issues. I think we as a town government all of us, whether it's the selectmen, the planning board, the town administration, the conservation commission, there's so many different boards, board of appeals, so many different boards and committees and town officials involved in this whole process for a number of years. We have to keep our eye on the long-term strategic interest, the best interest of the town in the long term. I think the best interest in the town in the long term is for the mixed-use development. But that's not before the board at this time. What's before you currently, obviously, relates to the affordable housing 40B development. And in sitting in the audience and listening to the discussion, while I understand the issues of the open space and the benefits that the other proposal would bring, it does seem that what's before you tonight is really what needs to be voted upon rather than any discussion of joint meetings. That may be a great idea, and maybe that if we ever get to that stage, maybe that's something that we should be entertaining. But it seems that obviously you have to vote on the application that's before you. That's what the applicant is asking for. And as one member of the board, I support them in seeking to finish up their 40B approvals and try to get to the next stage, because I think over the past so many months working with Mr. Connolly, I think he and I have developed a relationship of trust. I've had very good negotiations with Mr. Connolly, and I think that at the end of the day we can reach a good outcome at this site. But that's not currently before us, and it may not be before us, and depending on, you know, on what the current applicant before you is willing to enter into with the town. So whether or not they're willing to go forward with any negotiations, they have before you a different application tonight. I don't pretend to know all of the law in this and whether the different versions of open space, where that ultimately may come out. But I think it's important to keep in mind the demolition costs that the town may be facing. We have much better uses for $320,000 than demolishing the town-owned property and figuring out some alternative plan with it if this project does go forward. And I think there's been references to a lot of history here, and that's true. This has been going on for probably 10 or 12 years. There's probably a lot of mistakes that have been made all around. But looking forward and onward and upward from where we are is the best way to approach this. And we are where we are. Rather than looking back, we're trying to look forward. We're trying to reach the best outcome for the town at this site. And I just wanted to bring those items to your attention and to personally, as one member of the board, support the application that's currently before you, with the hope that we would then, if it's approved, we would then move on to another negotiation, finish that up, and hopefully then go to the planning board and reach what I think would be a better proposal. But
ask a question? And actually, I should make a statement first. It doesn't matter to us whether this is a 40B project or mixed use. I mean, 40B projects, we are in desperate need of affordable units in our town, and that's a high priority for the state and for the citizens. So from a zoning perspective or a project perspective, it doesn't matter. We're just looking at the environmental component of it. That's the statement. The question is this. How do you propose, actually to the applicant, how do you propose that we take a vote on this when we have an outstanding enforcement order? Now, I'll give you some history, and I think I was probably wrong for about a decade, but I used to believe that there was a bylaw in Milton that said that any board could not issue a permit if the applicant was in violation of another permit. And then I went searching for it. I could never find the bylaw. But that's certainly been over 23 years. That's been the history and the uniform practice of the Conservation Commission. And that is that we never issued another permit unless we had resolved the first permit. So I'm not sure how to proceed in the absence of resolving the enforcement order. And we seem to be a little bit at odds in terms of how to correct it. And Steve, that's why I asked you, are you aware of the cost of putting in larger caliper trees? Because I don't think we can resolve one without resolving both. And I'm not trying to leverage that part of it against you, but I don't think that we can proceed to have one vote without two votes. And I'm not sure what your expectation is, and we haven't even entertained a motion as to what to do with the enforcement order. But certainly, we would require some mitigation as, you know, before we even get to this point. We need to resolve the enforcement order. To do so, it might hit you with a cost that you're not expecting. We don't even know what the cost is. But let's say we said, okay, you're going to put in three trees and you're going to put in three, I don't know, I'll make it up, 12-inch caliper trees, two at the library and one at Glover School. If we can't get you to shrink the building and put one in there. We don't know what the cost of that is, and I don't think you do either. And I don't want to put an uncertainty into the project. And I'd like your response or your input. I don't have a direct question, but I'm not sure how you would react if we took a vote right now to say, okay, we want three 14-inch caliber trees or 12-inch caliber trees. And you're going to say, okay, what is that going to cost me? You don't know, and we don't know. And I don't know what that would do to, you know, the whole economic analysis. And I'm not trying to use that as leverage, but I think we have to resolve it. And maybe somebody will make a motion to plant three, you know, 4-inch caliber or 5-inch caliber trees.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Back to what I mentioned earlier, in terms of mitigating with numbers, maybe we have 6-inch caliber trees.
I don't know. I don't think 6-inch caliber trees would satisfy everybody on the board.
All right, so how about 1-12 and 5-6s? Right,
what's the cost?
We have to, you know.
We have to be creative.
That's exactly right.
I agree with you.
And it's been reasonable and respectful of the environment so that we accomplish something. I don't want to plant 5-12-inch dead trees or 6-12 trees that are going to be, you know, five are going to die and one's going to survive. That's going to go totally against anything that we would want. So what can we come up with that is feasible? Say, I'll make a motion for 1-12-inch tree and 5-6-inch trees as mitigation.
What if that passed? They're going to say, what is that going to cost me?
Everybody has to take a risk.
Mr. Chairman, I can say that.
Choice.
The 4 to 5-inch caliper is going to run about $2,500 installed, roughly. It's about $1,000, but it's not usually you double it. But for a tree that size, probably got to add a little more because of the equipment that's needed, the men.
I'm sorry, say that again. 4 to 5-inch caliber tree is
going to run about $2,500 a tree.
Installed.
Is that what I gave you?
Right. Well, first of all, does anybody disagree that we have to resolve both of these issues?
We can just tell them. If they want to get rid of the enforcement order, we just tell them what they have to do. They can't appeal it. You can't appeal an enforcement order. I keep telling you that. And so, what if they don't like it?
John,
I don't care if they don't like it.
I was just being diplomatic.
I would offer that it's in the interest of all the parties for us to clear the decks.
Okay. Comments on... The proposal is for 5?
6-inch, 12-inch.
What is one of those big scoops that we were describing before to pick up a tree that's more like 12 inches? I think you're talking $20,000, probably $30,000 a tree.
I've seen it on this old house.
Yeah, and I think it's about $20,000 or $30,000. Does that
they
sound
do it all the time.
About right
to
you? You know, one of those enormous scoops space where you can take. I think I had heard that it's about $20,000 or $30,000 for a tree. Of
for
that
a 12
size.
Inch, for a 12 inch.
For 12 inch. It would actually come. So then you have a huge canopy. So if we did 4 of those instead, but then you're talking about $80,000, maybe $100,000 it would be costing. We could ask for that instead.
What?
I would just say that
you did.
It's going to be more difficult to find locations for those than it is for small, from my point of view.
I mean, we certainly can find it.
Corner of Eric Drive and School Street.
6 times $2,500.
Call what? Corner of Eric Drive and School Street.
Yeah, 25K.
And I'm still going to argue on survivability, even on a 12-inch.
Well,
you know, I want 6 trees to survive.
Well, an alternate strategy would be to say
25K.
3 trees in one location over a period of time until you have a survivable tree.
Right.
Yeah. So you could say we'll plant one tree at 12 inches at a given location.
Until this is survivable, until all the trees are
well,
survivable?
No.
You go on for infinity.
No, you pick a number. You say what your number is, but the goal is to have a survivable tree. So you could say, this is the location we're going to plant it. Assume that there's going to be a total, a maximum number of three.
Again, there's a motion on the table. It's not been seconded, so maybe if you disagree with that one, somebody should suggest another motion.
I'm just throwing out another idea. You're talking about quantities and...
No, I'm actually favoring Arthur's.
Okay.
5 and 1. But there's no magic to it, and I don't want to be arbitrary. I think there has to be some rational basis for it. And I think the rational basis is that we had an extraordinary tree that we lost. And I say that, Steve, and I recognize, you know, what you said. Gene, did you have a...
Yes, Mr. Perrin, excuse me for interrupting.
That's fine.
As a taxpayer, and, you know, like everyone else in this room here, I see it kind of as a moot argument on these trees, quite honestly. The way I look at it, I sat at this table 5 years ago with the planning board, and I begged them to do one or the other, pick something. Had we done the 38 condos and the mixed use, we're talking between $350,000, $400,000 a year that all the taxpayers have missed out on, plus the improved property values down in that neighborhood. Now, if Mr. Conley agrees to do these trees, and then he has to sit down with the selectmen and the planning board and you folks again to do a new deal back to the 38 condominiums, I'm sure part of that negotiation is going to be, well, I got $100,000 in new trees, so I can't take $100,000 off of this. Again, it's the taxpayers who are going to pay here. And thank you for your time. That's the way I see it.
You lost me at the very end.
I understand. The town is going to go into negotiations with the Conleys, right, Carrick Realty. They already offered $400,000 for this property several years ago, which the town somehow ended up not accepting after having taken a $40,000 deposit that was deposited in their escrow account. But the bottom line is whatever cost you add on now, I'm sure it's going to be figured into the next negotiation where the selectmen and others are trying to get the 38 condos and mixed use back on the table. That's all I'm saying is money's finite. And I say, you know, the developers are in this to make a dollar. And if you raise that cost, we have to make it up. The taxpayers are making it up. That's all I'm saying.
Right. And, but you know, I actually never thought of that.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Thoughts?
It all seems to come back to me as to why we're not talking about the real issue, the, you know, the big elephant in the room. Why aren't we talking about the plan that everybody wants to have? I know we have to go. I know because
we fought on the enforcement order tonight.
Yes.
Right. And then the plans get changed next. So next, he's coming back. Steve's coming back with the multi-use plan instead.
We don't want to use that as leverage.
No, I'm not suggesting that. I'm asking a question. Can we revisit this enforcement order at that point, or does this stand firm? We can't revisit it? Are you sure?
I suppose you could revisit anything, but that sounds like we're just trying to leverage them. I don't like the sound of that.
Well,
I think we ought to vote.
We need to move it forward. I don't think anyone wants to hold this up. I think we need to find a way forward.
I certainly don't want to hold it up, no.
Mr. Connolly could win the lottery tonight and then decide that he doesn't want to build a building. Somebody else will. Right?
Okay, so I think we have to move forward. There's a motion on the table. You've got five 6-inch trees, one 12-inch tree, with location to be decided.
Species to be decided. I'm of the opinion that it needs to be a potential
survivability.
Legacy kind of tree. But the trees we're talking about are not red oaks. They're maybe it's a beech. Maybe it's something that's. I'm deferring to someone, to you, just in terms of.
Extremely slow growing. Extremely. Beeches are beautiful.
Well, I'm just throwing out beech as an idea.
No, I agree with you. And they're legacy trees and they're beautiful.
But they're not native. We want to stick with native.
Native.
So we could do hackberries that have done quite well.
Why don't we just be generic and say native legacy trees? And then
to be approved.
A variety of legacy.
Well, let's be specific. We could say two red oaks and three hackberry, which are doing great and are fast growing. And They're not easy to find, but they've done really well by the Neponset. I would go along with that. Now, what size caliber are we talking about?
Well, that's...
It was 112 and what, five or six?
Six.
So two red oak and three hackberry are the 5-6 inches, and then the 12 inches what?
I mean, that can be a showcase tree, and we need to talk about survivability, of course. I mean, that can be a showcase tree.
Well, we should think about black cherries. That's what people are, you know, they have more life in them in terms of caterpillars that I was talking about before. So let's say...
And longevity?
Longevity.
I mean, we should consider longevity. What's a longevity?
Black cherry.
What is the longevity?
150 years. Oaks are older, but that's enough.
And that'll grow to a how large of a tree?
Same as an oak, 200 feet.
Town forest someplace.
Okay, is that okay?
It's acceptable to me. Yeah, I like that.
Okay, wait a minute. So I get it. You have two red oaks,
three hackberry, and a black cherry.
The large caliber black cherry.
Large caliber. We could do that.
Is that your motion, Arthur?
And there was the six.
Acceptable.
Inches, right?
Yes. Correct.
112 and what was it five cherry. Or six?
Five.
Arthur, 5-6 inch caliber.
And location to be decided by whom?
By us.
Well, we need the input from DPW or Parks and Recreation or somebody.
School Department.
Town of Milton.
School Department. Yeah.
Do you want selectmen with the conservation approval of the location, but get suggestions?
Yes. Okay. Location to be approved by the Conservation Commission.
Fine.
That's the motion.
Yeah. Yes.
Seconded. All right. Any discussion? All in favor?
You agree.
All right. Unanimous? Okay, done. Okay, now we're on to the main motion, which is is there a motion to approve? Now, we don't want to get ahead of ourselves because we do have a lot of conditions, and we should probably list those conditions. One of them, of course, is an LSP.
Right.
On board. But I think we addressed that last
yes, right.
Last night. We've got drainage. Are the drainage calculations sufficient for everybody's approval?
All right.
We've got our.
I saw the information.
We've got our regular boilerplate conditions.
And the mitigation of the retention basins, they're all going to remain the same anyway as far as the terms and conditions for the construction. After the demolition, so a lot of that is in place anyway.
Yes, that's correct.
Right,
that's correct. So we would, and have you seen the
yes.
Order conditions
right.
For the?
Yes.
Okay, so we can actually fold those the same.
Fold it into
terms and conditions.
Yes.
Into the project.
Right.
All right. Now, one of the things you have to be aware of, and your contractor has to be aware of, is that on for the construction staging area,
mm-hmm.
This is a riverfront area. Which is 200 feet in jurisdiction. We've always, as part of our boilerplate, you can't store equipment within 100 feet of the resource area. I don't think that's going to be a problem for you on your site, because I think you're more than 100 feet away, or at least you can find space.
Yeah, 100 feet right. There.
Okay, but that's definitely one of our
conditions.
Conditions. There's no refueling, there's no storage, there's no overnight storage.
Mm-hmm.
There'll be a spill protection plan in case that a hydraulic
something lets go or whatever. Right.
So we've got our regular boilerplate, the conditions that we put in the demo order conditions, the licensed site professional, and we actually need a, I think the LSP will say this, but we definitely need a site assessment in terms of what's there in surrounding the tanks and underneath the foundation. And of course it would be DEP required mitigation of any contamination.
Right.
It would be found.
Is the LSP going to be from day one or after? After the work.
After the work.
Right.
No, it says it is.
We're on the site development.
Right.
No. From day one.
There was some talk that, well, we're going to do the work, then we'll have the LSP come in and make sure everything we did complied.
Oh, no. I think that discussion was over the demolition.
When we get the buildings down, before we start any groundwork, we're going to hire an LSP.
Yes. Right, that's the way I understand.
That's the way everybody.
Right. Yeah.
And that's what's written into our decision, actually. We actually agreed to that for our 40B, a Board of Appeal decision.
Okay.
It's written in that way.
All right.
I've never seen the decision, so I don't know.
It's on file at the town clerk's office.
We don't get it.
Well, you can, it's open from, I think, 9 to 5.
I think I handed in a copy.
Where is it? I'm sorry, we have to stall again. I apologize. And thank you, members of the public, for your patience. I know we've been delayed and slow tonight.
Nebulizer, inhaler.
This is a lot better than what you...
In the midst of all this, in the midst of all this, my granddaughter's first video. Tore up my backyard, it was a torn nursery.
Yes, because I'm going to need
to negotiate to get my oil tank removed. Oh, God.
Wow.
Saturday was much very good. 12 inch tribute. I started at 5.
Take one out of my yard. I got a nice beach.
No, it's going bad. Go adjust the dog. Pick up the dog. Came back. That was a real possible road race to get one of the cakes.
She's in the shot.
Is that what they said?
Yeah. Just don't.
We all set?
Back in session, folks.
So we have the, you know, the background terms and conditions of the motion on your notice of intent. Is there a motion among the commissioners to approve the notice of intent and issue an order of conditions with those expert and special conditions?
There's an awful lot of unanswered questions. Okay. That we have discussed and kind of pushed aside. Okay. So
what would those
time be? Is late now, and I am not in favor of something that I don't know all the answers to.
Well, I think then you have to list the questions that are we're missing information right. on, I so could, that they know.
I could go on for pages.
Well, just start. Not the one. What's your first question? No, I mean that.
Go ahead.
Continue. Craig, if there are unanswered questions, if you have unanswered questions, then the public may as well. We've done the stormwater discharge, right? We're going to fold in our...
I've never seen anything from Joe Lynch saying he approved of all this.
Absolutely.
He deferred it to us.
Right.
Right.
What do I know about stormwater going into the Pine Creek Brook? What basis do I have to tell... Okay, to make a decision whether the oil separator, the primary oil separator, is enough to protect the Neponset River. Okay.
Well,
they just have a typical oil trap, oil separator, one oil separator. As the water goes into the Pine Tree Brook in there, and Joe Lynn says, "Oh well, it's up to the Conservation Commission."
Well, the oil separator has to be sufficient to get the oil out of it. So whether or not it's a 10-inch separator or a
do you know how long oil separators in this town last to catch patients?
First time they
clean them out, they pop the cast iron, drop in the clamshell, bang, off goes the oil separator. It's a little cast iron device that sits there.
Oh, okay, but that's an ongoing, that's part of an O&M plan, and that's, I believe that's part of the...
I haven't seen any of that.
There was an operation and maintenance plan submitted with the application. I just want to just jump in, because I know one of the requirements that came up that the commission has is on oil and water separators. And when we were in front of the ZBA, Peter was reminding me that, we deferred to the commission on, the oil and gas separators to make sure we met your standards for it. And then in our conversations with Joe Lynch and John Thompson, we said, we need, we want you to agree with this in concept. so that way the commission can agree with the discharge points, and then we go back to the DPW for the stormwater permit, which will define all of the parameters. And again, it's, you know, we're working through all the departments in town the best way we can in terms of organizing those.
Well, then, I appreciate you saying it that way, but that actually gives some credence to what Craig has said. That, I mean, my understanding was the O&M plan would require a continuous maintenance of those right. oil separators. I thought it said that, but...
The operation and maintenance plan for any of the proprietary stormwater devices that we have to be maintained annually, and that's what was provided to the commission. That's part of the initial notice of intent submission. Yes, sir.
And that was my understanding as well.
Yes, sir.
Is that...
Siltation barriers. It was up to the Conservation Commission to tell the contractor when the siltation barriers had washed away. Okay? That's what's in there.
I'm sorry. So what we typically provide as our standard conditions for an erosion and sediment control plan is that the measures have to be in place. Obviously, the measures have to be approved by the Conservation Commission. And then our standard condition is that they get inspected by, you know, the site engineers and or the conservation personnel, whomever you feel is appropriate. And those measures may be added to, replaced as necessary, as directed by a representative of the commission or by the engineers to make sure that they remain functioning.
That's already in the order that I got for the demo. That within 48 hours, if there's a breakdown of the erosion control, that it'll be fixed.
Right.
That's already in there. Yeah, so why are we...
Right.
There are valid points, though, that we just want to make sure that those are... And I did say that they would be rolled into... In anyway. The order of conditions, if one issue.
Okay. Now, does the environmental noise, the decibel limit that we talked about during the site, during the demolition, mm-hmm. does that carry over for the site work? Didn't we?
That is in the conditions on the demolition.
It is in the conditions.
Demolition.
Right?
Yes. Does that correct. Carry over during the site work?
We're carrying we them just, all over. We,
everything.
John
everything
just said everything gets carried over.
They all do.
This is all from a previous meeting, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Correct. And do you have a copy of it?
It's in the folder.
One right here. Can you,
oh.
This is here.
Do you want it? Or
no, give it to Craig or Ingrid.
The noise is the very last one. It's 52.
The last one. These are the special. The rest is the boilerplate.
I remember.
We've got a great.
You were here, right?
We've got a great deal of rock to be removed, right?
Now, they're valid questions, Craig, that I think some of them are answered. So keep asking. And I want to make sure that we're all on the same page.
I'm gonna die. Of information. Okay, go ahead. Continue.
It's you.
No, it's you. It's back to you. We've got the oil separators, the discharge into Pine Tree Pond.
I'm trying to catch my breath. Okay. I'm done.
Okay. Is there any other information that we think we're lacking? Okay. I mean, obviously, we've got issues with the size of the building, and I don't know how people are going to vote, but that's, we've had a full discussion and frank discussion, and I think we're probably ready to vote. Is there a motion?
I'll move to approve.
Is there a second?
The conditions as cited and reported to Kathy.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 4-2. It's denied. But I reiterate that, you know, I know there'll be an appeal process, but we stand ready to have a special meeting. We don't want to delay this. We think that there's a resolution that's out there.
Thank you.
Let's continue conversation. Asking for the benefit.
I'll show you.
A few years ago, no, 2 days later. Keep going.
Vote on the resolution of the enforcement order.
We did.
Did you do it? Oh, that was, we did, okay.
I think we need to revisit that because I think we misspoke on the size of those trees, and I want Kathy to read back what she said. I think we need to go. What was the size of the trees? Because I just looked up.
Kathy wrote 1, 12, and 5.
6.
I think so.
Yeah, I don't know whether we can get a black cherry that we specified at that size. I don't think we can.
Well, I think we agreed that it was black cherry. I think we agreed.
One of those trees would be, so we can get, a red oak, yeah, we could get it at that,
yeah,
size.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, a legacy tree, I mean, it can be done and it can be guaranteed. I mean, the vendor will guarantee, the people that do that will guarantee. And we should stipulate survivability, of course.
Did we take a vote to rescind the enforcement order?
No, they have to comply.
Huh?
They have to comply.
Right. Okay.
Then the enforcement order is relieved. Okay, next on the agenda is notice of intent 395 Hillside Street.
Maybe I did. I understood you perfectly then. I was afraid for a minute there that I hadn't.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
My name is Jeff Kane with LAL Engineering Group. I'm representing the owner, the Rubens, for their application, notice of intent application for 395 Hillside Street, septic system replacement. It's been a while since we've seen each other, obviously, on the sidewalk, and I think we did have one informal meeting just to kind of initially discuss this project. But since this is our first public hearing, we'll give a quick synopsis in the background. Obviously, the owners, as you are well aware, are looking to change this three-bedroom home with the addition of a bedroom and bathroom and a carriage house into a four-bedroom home to accommodate family and friends visiting and things of that nature. To have that happen, we have to update the existing three-bedroom septic system on site that was installed in around 1999 in a conventional Title V manner with pipes and stone. We have to replace this with a system that will accommodate the new four-bedroom design of the carriage house addition. And in order to do this, we needed to use a approved alternative technology, in particular something called the Presby Enviro Septic System, Advanced Enviro Septic System. We currently do not have the setbacks on the site to put in a conventional Title V system. So we had to come up with a different idea to do this. First off, we had to go to the Board of Health to get some waivers to allow this to happen. We successfully did that by presenting this Title V, this Presby system, as an improvement over the existing piping stone system that exists out there today. So with that in hand, Board of Health gave us the waivers to allow this to go forward. So with that, we've gone ahead and come in front of you to show the environmental impacts, or at least the buffer zone impacts as a result of putting this new system in. If I could, I'll show it here on the plan. Well, first off, the environmental septic system, we had mentioned to you folks before, last time we were in front of you, is a different type of technology that provides effluent treatment within the pipe itself, as opposed to a stone and pipe system that relies on the stone and soil beneath the system and the microbes in those soils to treat the effluent. Now, the pipe, the Presby system has a plastic corrugation around it with almost like a mesh that allows this treatment to happen within the pipe.
What's that called again? Can you spell it?
Advanced enviroseptic. I can show you the...
Presby?
Yeah, that's what...
Presby.
That's the word I didn't get. What is it?
P-R-E-S-B-Y. That's the manufacturer's
name. Ah, okay. Okay, and that's sort of a term of art. Okay.
Okay. So again, what they do is, if I can show you a quick little sketch here too. A standard pipe and stone system has a perforated pipe surrounded by stone. Mm-hmm. And the effluent comes out and percolates through this stone, and it forms something called a biomat, where most of your treatment happens here. And what happens is water percolates through the biomat, gets treated here, and there's additional treatment within this area beneath the zone here. This is typically why you have a 4-foot separation to your groundwater, because the treatment happens below that pipe. Mm-hmm. The soils beneath this pipe are responsible for the treatment of the effluent. Mm-hmm. Now, in the Presby system, you have a pipe with a mesh around it. And when the effluent comes into this pipe, this biomat that typically forms in the soil now forms around the circumference of this pipe within that mesh.
So what is it? It's like a...
It's a really a plastic. It's a plastic mesh is what that is.
And the pore size is
the what?
The pore size of the mesh, so it keeps the bacteria in.
Well, it's surrounded by a filter fabric. There's where, you know, that's what holds it in. It allows it to hold in and form this biomat on this fabric mesh that's on the inside of that.
Okay, so the mesh keeps the bacteria, is sized such that the bacteria are retained.
It's a medium for it to grow on.
No, it's designed as a matrix that allows the biomat, the biofilm, to form inside the pipe.
Right.
The mesh isn't designed to prevent the bacteria from flowing out of the pipe.
Okay.
It's
okay.
Just providing a substrate for the biomat to form rather than forming below
this
the system.
This biomat
the soil.
That would be below the pipe is now around the circumference of the
mm-hmm.
pipe. So all the treatment happens inside this pipe now.
Mm-hmm.
The area below, the sand and soil below, is just for dispersal at this point. There's no longer any.
So it's not that they can't get out. They prefer to stay in because that's their matrix.
That's where, right, that's where it's formed and that's where it
okay.
is. So it's such that on a typical Title V system, as you know, it's a 4-foot separation to groundwater.
Mm-hmm.
In a system like this, you can actually take credit to get only 2 feet to groundwater, since all the treatment happens within that pipe.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we've also submitted to you folks as well a study that was done comparing the leachate of the enviroseptic and the standard Title V system. I'm not sure if you've had a chance to review it. But what it does show is that the COD, the BOD, the ammonia, the phosphates, the bacteria, the solids, and some of the total nitrogen is actually reduced as compared to a Title V system. So it is a more efficient type
mm-hmm.
treatment system. So all that said, what we're looking to do is we have an existing Title V system out here. And this new system will fit within that same footprint because it is a more efficient treatment system. So we're looking to have a temporary alteration of this area outside the 25-foot buffer zone, but obviously within the 100-foot buffer zone. I'm not sure if you can see it here, and I can actually brought some colored markers. What you had asked to see before was the limit of the driveway, which is right here. So you can see the footprint of this is within the limit of this driveway. So we're looking to do a temporary alteration to excavate this old system out, place the new system in place, and put the existing driveway back within the same footprint as was previous. Temporary alteration ends up with a better system for better treatment of the effluent.
How long will it take for the bacteria to grow onto the system?
It depends on the use of the system. Like in any septic system, it could be, I think they said at one point it was 30 days, but again, it depends on the use of the system.
Is it ineffective prior to the formation?
It's obviously less effective, absolutely, right.
Do you precede it, though? With
no, you don't precede any septic system. And I should say, in this case here...
This is a different model.
Yeah, and in this case here, it'll be a little quicker because we're not changing out the septic tank. So your colony of bacteria that's in here is going to transfer over to here a lot quicker than you would new construction with a brand new septic tank. But it's going to take a while to colonize this tank, so...
The detail on the next page shows that the new septic system is actually an elevated system relative to the existing grade.
Right.
That wasn't something that we had talked about before.
It's a typical cross-section, that's all that's showing.
Yeah, but my understanding was that you were putting the new septic system in the same footprint within the footprint of the existing septic system.
Yes.
But that I wasn't under the impression that it was being elevated.
It's not a mounted system. Again, this is just a typical section.
Okay, that's a typical detail. So what we're talking about is not that detail.
No.
It's a flush level condition.
It is flush. I think it ends up being, once we do the first design we showed you before we finally got into the final design, what we want to do is, right now the driveway is over the top of this system. Okay.
Right.
This system is not designed to have a driveway on top of it. They call that H20 loading, which is a highway or roadway loading. That's not designed for that now, but that's being used as that.
Is that why it failed?
It hasn't failed.
It hasn't failed.
Right, it hasn't failed.
Just larger capacity.
Right, we just need to upgrade the capacity to a separate bedroom.
Right.
Has the potential, though, absolutely. Once you start running traffic over this, we don't know the condition of these pipes, but so it has that potential. But once we get the H20 loading over the top of this Presby system, I think we end up with about 8-inch difference initially that we'll just grade down to meet the existing right there. So it's not a significant difference, but there is a slight grade difference.
What about a
mounted system by any means.
What about a fire truck or a trash truck or a oil delivery truck going over there?
That's part of the H20 loading. And obviously, there have been delivery trucks out here before. And again, I'm not sure what the system is out there. But we've designed it for the H20 loading, which would take into account those type of vehicles.
I went on the Presby site and reviewed all of that. And that's exactly how it's intended.
Yeah.
So you did dig a test well.
We used the existing test pits that were done previously.
Okay,
and
so
again,
there's
nothing changing with the...
Is this the second side of this?
It is the second, yeah.
Okay. Sorry, 1 second.
You used the existing... You went to the original and re-excavated?
Used the existing data for the test pits.
So you know the soil that's below. You know that
the
soil
parent material is not going to change in this time frame.
You're just setting a new one over the top.
What has happened previously is that you had a parent material here, a subsoil. They dug that out, and down here you have what you call this is your parent material, the material that you're perking into, material that's underlying the entire system. We're going in, taking out that same area, scarifying, and putting back this new system up in here. That parent material is not changing.
Okay, and it was viable at that time,
exactly.
And the assumption is it's continuing to be viable.
It's got an 8-minute permitted, 8-minute per inch perk, which is ideal.
Okay, and we talked about the perimeter non-permeable skirt that was going to be added. On the drawing, it shows a monitoring well being installed near the street on the side.
Right here.
I had two questions on this. One is, shouldn't the monitoring well be installed at the lowest grade?
Mm-hmm.
Because anything is going to naturally migrate that way. And the second question is, should the monitoring well actually be installed outside of the impermeable barrier rather than inside the impermeable barrier?
To answer your first question, per this system design, boilerplate design, it will get a monitoring well within the low part of the system, within the pipe system.
Naturally.
The monitoring well that you folks had wanted was above and beyond. And let's back up a little bit. The impervious barrier, we talked about it before, it's not required in this system by any means. There's no reason to have it. I think everyone felt a little more comfortable that if for some reason something did happen, there was some type of impervious skirt around the system that would prevent unforeseen issues going in toward that street.
Correct.
Okay, so that's good. Belt and suspenders as far as that goes.
Yep.
Monitoring well was requested, so obviously we put it in. We have one again going in the lower end already. Inside, outside of this area, I actually kind of I thought about that back and forth. It doesn't matter. If you want it on the outside, it's okay. On the inside, if there was an issue, you're going to catch it to see something happening.
But on the inside, you would expect something.
No, not at all. You'll never see something on the inside of that.
Why not? Isn't the inside inherently within the bio? I mean, you're not in the biomap, but you're in the zone of.
If we look at this section here, we have impervious barrier here.
Yep.
impervious barrier here.
Yep.
The only time you would see something in a monitoring well here is if you had some type of catastrophic failure. That's why I said it's not required for this system because the drainage is going straight down. It's never going to migrate that far.
So we should never see anything there.
No. So it doesn't matter on one side or the other. If you saw something there, you'd have an issue. If you saw something here, you'd have an issue. It's I think it's six of one, half dozen of the other.
So the well that's the monitoring well that's that was originally intended to be in the system at that corner, which is the lowest corner.
Right.
Would you, because it's within the footprint of the system,
right,
would you expect to see something in that?
No.
Or the depth of that monitoring well is deep enough that it needs to be percolate through
the only thing that would happen is moist soil with a heavy use, which you're not going to find in a monitoring well. You're not going to see standing water in that well.
Right.
It's more of an issue if there's a failure. The same thing that you folks are asking for on that second well, that's what that is. It's an observation port in case there was an issue. If you find standing water in there, you have a problem.
Okay. Just to clarify, I didn't understand when we were on site that there was a monitoring well within the system.
Yes, and it wasn't mentioned.
And if that is the case, I'm not sure that a second well is necessary. The well was requested based on the idea that nothing was there.
Mm-hmm.
From my perspective, if there's one that would normally be designed and it would show us a condition of a failure, that's enough.
Okay.
But we do. But from my perspective, we do want the impermeable barrier because we do have the stream there, and we want to know that we're going that there's nothing migrating horizontally.
And that's provided for the Board of Health. They wanted to make sure there's something between the foundation, so it just wraps around the
border. I agree with you, Michael. It makes sense.
Yeah.
All right, so the monitoring well can come out. Like I said, it's a monitoring just to see if there's a failure. If there's never going to be if there's standing water in there, there's an issue. What would happen is the plumbing backed up in the house. What's going on? Well, instead of taking a guess, whatever, you can go out and say, well, there's standing water here. We have an issue. So,
Is it a standard practice to test that well or evaluate that well on a regular basis? Or
No, not at all.
So what would trigger someone to go out and evaluate
that
well?
Like you said, a failure of that system somehow, and you want to get an idea of what's going on.
Yeah, but how do you know what's going on?